I really have a strong sense and a powerful suspicion that our current understanding of the physical world as this, you know, gargantuan space, mostly empty, is just as short-sighted as the Ptolemaic conception of the solar system was, you know, 500 years ago, and that we are on the verge of a transformation in our Weltanschauung that will clue us into the fact that no matter how large that outer space may seem to us, it pales in comparison to the depths of the interiority of our own consciousness. And so, you know, a lot of materialists will say, oh, we're just, you know, some slime on a rock orbiting a, you know, middle-sized star in a half-ray galaxy or whatever, mm-hmm. because we're so dwarfed by these infinite spaces. But I think with a slight reorientation in our sense of perspective, all of that hardly matters and doesn't make us insignificant at all, because after all, we're the ones that thinks that we know all of that. And, you know, we've discussed over the course of these few hours a series of inversions which have occurred in the history of philosophy. And I think we're on the verge of another one that will reorient us to thinking of human consciousness not just as a little blip inside of this gigantic cosmos, but to bring more parity to the relationship between cosmos and consciousness. That actually consciousness has a far more important role to play in this universe than we might suspect if we imagine that, you know, we're just some slime growing on the edge of a rock in this infinite expanse of empty space.
Firstly, that's beautiful. Thank you for sharing that with me. Jung's idea of psychological well-being was heavily based on the individual. So rather than you focusing on society, you focus on yourself and your family and society in that order, something akin to that. Now, when you said that you're interested in the human being, I'm interested in if you are interested in Matt, or if you abstract away to the human being. So when you're sitting and you're philosophizing and you're ruminating, what are you thinking about? Are you actually decontextualizing to the point of saying the human being, quote unquote? Or are you also trying to understand who is it that you are, Matt? Hmm.
Well, it's both. I think there's a way in which that which is most intimate and personal for each of us actually opens out into what's most universal. You see this in great works of art, you know, where a novelist or, you know, any kind of artist gives expression to something that is so personal and seemingly idiosyncratic and bizarre, but actually everyone can really connect with it because we feel that that person is being authentic. And even if, you know, we don't share that idiosyncratic thing with them, we can still recognize that, like, inner weirdness that we all feel about the sheer fact that we exist. And when someone exposes themselves fully, it's like we just feel that connection with them and say, like, thank you, like, I feel more human now.
My background is in math, physics, and filmmaking, and so in screenwriting there's an adage which says the more personal the pain, the more general, and the more general the pain, the less personal it is. So I concur, and I hope to bring some of that to this podcast as well. So often, especially in longer conversations like with Ian McGilchrist or Carl Friston and so on, I get quite personal, and even you're getting quite personal now. And so I'm a fan. I do believe there's something to this adage. And if you try and speak in these cliched generalities, it doesn't resonate with people. So anyhow, please tell us about your personal opinion.
Well, hopefully people can get through the first 2 hours of this conversation about the most general statements one can make about the universe and metaphysics, and get to the kernel of it in this last however much time. But you know, you mentioned Jung and the emphasis on the individual, and you're absolutely right about that. But, you know, Jung would also say that the deeper we go into our own individuality, the more we start to enter back into the collective unconscious, which for Jung was not just the collective unconscious of our species, of all humanity, but the collective unconscious of all of life. And indeed, you know, later in his career, he was recognizing the ways in which the depths of the psyche open out into the cosmos. And, you know, this is where his ideas of synchronicity come into play, that there is some profound relationship between the inner depths of the psyche and the outer expanses of the cosmos. And so, you know, I think his point there was, let us be very careful not to rush into various social movements, political movements, when what's really happening is we're projecting our own personal psychological complexes onto the world, and we have unresolved issues that, and or blaming other people, or we're blaming big abstractions. You know, we're blaming capitalism. It's all capitalism's fault, which is, what is capitalism exactly? And, you know, we can have whole debates about various political economies and how the system should be run. But if we're having those debates, especially when we start to get really heated and, you know, we have a phenomenon unfolding right now in the US where somebody murders a CEO and everybody's like, cheering him on, he's become a folk hero. And I get the anger and the frustration, but at the same time, when we start to justify vigilantism and murder, we're stepping away from the individual as the locus of ultimate value. Individual souls, individual psyches are, I would say, the locus of ultimate value. And as soon as you allow a soul to become a means to whatever your ideological end is, such that you're willing to murder that person, I no longer know what the basis for this ideal of justice that you might claim to be fighting for is. Justice, you know, this is a Platonic perspective, but like, unless souls are the locus of value that we're trying to seek justice for, then I'm not sure how you could fight for justice if you're willing to just murder individuals in pursuit. It's like your ideal of justice has become too abstract. You've lost the plot, as it were. And so, you know, this is why we need to seek some balance here. Like, I'm not saying politics is a distraction or something, but we need to not neglect our own individual psyche and not imagine that, you know, fall into this trap of thinking, oh, well, if only the good people were in charge, everything would be fine, and we just need to kill off the bad people. Because that's the projection of evil onto those people over there. And I think we really need to recognize that, that evil lives potentially in each of us. And if we're going to overcome evil, start at home, start with yourself. All of the greatest crimes of history are a result of the projection of evil onto those people over there. And watching current events unfold, it's like, gosh, we haven't learned a damn thing.
So what have you learned?
You see this, it's a little blurry, but there's this painting behind me of Socrates. It's a French painter from the 1800s.
Jacques-Louis David.
David, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. It's actually from 1987, which is the same year as the second edition of the Critique of Pure Reason.
Nice.
So I thought you would be a fan of that.
Nice. Awesome. Thank you for that. It's a depiction of the Platonic dialogue, the Phaedo, which comes after the Apology, when Athens sentences Socrates to death for corrupting the youth and not believing in the gods of the Athenian state. And Socrates is actually offered exile instead of execution but he's like, I'm not afraid to die. And, you know, he felt a deep connection to his polis and accepted the judgment of his peers, even though he thought that they were wrong and he knew that history would judge them poorly. But he was ready to die. He was an old man. And so this painting depicts all of his students sort of in tears, like Socrates, just leave. Like, why are you doing, why are you killing yourself? And he's like, have I taught you nothing? Like, the soul is immortal. And so he's content to drink the hemlock and says in this dialogue, Plato has him say that all philosophy is preparation for dying. And
right.
One way of cutting through all the distractions of life is to remember that you and everyone you love is going to die. This is not a possibility. This is not a maybe. This is absolutely certain. And to live your life backwards from the perspective of death affords you the greatest possibility of living a meaningful life. Right? Because it's in that final moment before that transition. And I do imagine it as a transition, not just as an end, but I don't know. But it's in that moment that everything becomes condensed and the meaning that might be extracted from life becomes as salient as it could be. And if you consider the values of our contemporary civilization, it couldn't be further from this. We want to avoid death at all costs. We have a cult of youth, and you know, we want to not look at this inevitability, and so we live in denial for the most part, and we just want to accumulate goods and wealth and power, and you don't get to take any of that with you. Right. And so whether or not death is a transition or just an end, I think there's tremendous meaning to be reflected from staring it in the face and not being afraid of death like it's something terrible. It's actually the source of all the meaning that we might have in life. And again, I think that's part of putting the human being, the mystery of human existence, back at the center of all of our inquiry. We are mortal, and yet we have this intuition of immortality. We don't know what happens when we die, but it seems to radiate profundity, you know, just to imagine what that moment might be. And I, you know, for me, when people ask, how did you get interested in philosophy? I often tell the story of being a 7-year-old jumping on the bed as my mom was talking on the phone with a friend of hers. And I just realized, you know, she was perfectly healthy at the time, but I just realized, oh my God, my mom's going to die one day. And I just broke down in tears and I couldn't handle that as a 7-year-old. And it was like 2 weeks of crying off and on until I realized that I was going to die too. And my relationship to my own death wasn't sad. It wasn't a cause for, you know, crying hysterically. It was instead just profoundly mysterious to me. I couldn't understand how it could be possible. And then I started thinking about the fact that I was born, and I don't really remember being born. I just seem to have always been alive. And, you know, and so to project ahead towards death, it's like, maybe this isn't just a linear thing. All these creatures which have come before us over 4 billion years, that we exist today is a function of the fact that countless individual members of various species of organisms that are our ancestors have survived and achieved something. And we're inheriting all of that. And we should be grateful for that. And similarly, you know, presumably there will be a future, and what we achieve in the present will be inherited by those future beings. And if we can situate ourselves in that longer timeline, instead of thinking, oh, all that matters is, you know, this body, and when it dies, that's it, I'm out. Again, I think this is the basis the ethical basis for a very different type of civilization.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like the economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.